And many thanks to all our friends on The Five. Welcome to Hannity. This is a Fox News alert. By the way, we have an important opening monologue tonight about how the country could actually come together during difficult times as we now remember today the 16th anniversary of 9/11. That's coming up in just a few minutes. But first tonight, the city of Jacksonville, Florida is seeing record flooding. Millions in that state are still without power. And now Tropical Storm Irma is bringing its devastation to the state of Georgia. On the ground tonight in Columbus, Georgia, our friend, Fox News correspondent at large, I have no idea how he got down there, Geraldo Rivera. Geraldo, what's going on?
Hey, Sean, to tell you how I got down here, we landed in Charlotte, North Carolina, believe it or not. That was the closest airport. Then we drove down to Augusta, Georgia. From Augusta, Georgia to Atlanta, Georgia is where what is now Tropical Storm Irma was really visiting its wrath. Trees were down about every quarter of a mile. There was a great big tree across the road all the way to Atlanta. Hartsville Airport, the big airport, the world's busiest, hopelessly disrupted today. Thousands of flights canceled. Southwest had no flights. Delta, just a handful. They canceled over 3,000 of their flights. The rapid transit in Atlanta was closed all day today, Monday. Now we're down in Fort Benning, the sprawling army base that straddles the Georgia-Alabama line. Tropical Storm Irma passing through here now. This is the backside of the storm. Not much going on. Before I talk to the garrison commander, we were at the Chattahoochee River where there was tremendous flooding back in the day, 1990s. Then in 2009, Hurricane Irma came by and really visited some real wrath on the Peachtree State. Now you have a situation where here in Fort Benning, they are gearing up to help in the relief effort. Before we get there, at the Chattahoochee River, you won't believe what we saw. We interviewed Mayor Teresa Tomlinson, her town of 200,000, Columbus, Georgia. 30,000 of the folks in town have lost their power. But as we were doing an interview with the mayor here, well, you watch. Here is Mayor Tomlinson.
We're about in the eye of the storm right now. We really have gotten to where we got past the northern part, and it was about 40, 50 mile an hour winds there. We were expecting about 7 inches of rain, but the bottom half of the storm, Irma, has sheared off, and I think we might have caught a break.
I saw two knuckleheads actually jumping in the Chattahoochee River there and swimming through the rapids.
Well, and you're right. They are knuckleheads. That's very dangerous rapids. Those are class 3 rapids. At this point, probably much higher than that because of the volume. And they were very much in danger. But they luck was with them this evening. They got out.
Looks like your first responder is very much on the job.
Yeah, we have a swift water rescue team here, obviously, with class 4, class 5 rapids on the other side of the river here. We have to have that every now and then. There's a foolish person or two, and they have to come and get them out of the river.
This is Colonel Clint Cox. He's the garrison commander here at Fort Benning. Over 100,000 military personnel and civilians are at this base on a regular basis. We haven't seen each other since Kuwait when you were a mere captain.
Yes.
So usually, you know, the military is not involved in domestic affairs like storms and so forth. But you are all geared up. How does it feel to be a first responder in a sense?
This is what we do. We protect the American people every single day. So whether that's on foreign soils or here domestically, this is what we do. So we've been designated by FEMA as a incident support base, and we will be ready to receive all of the supporters that are going to head down to Florida to help take care of the folks down there. So.
And thoughts on 9/11?
Well, today is our day of remembrance. The good thing about the storm was we were able to be home with our families for a lot of us to remember about those things we all know. We had a lot of things scheduled today, we had a luncheon, a prayer luncheon this afternoon. Got wiped out by the weather, but at least we had folks home with their families, and they are all safe and sound and all accounted for today.
So, Sean, I know you've got a round robin of some of our brave reporters, but the tropical storm is heading into Alabama and then, going all the way, I think, up to Indiana. But you have storm trackers a lot more expertise than I. I wish you were here. We could have visited your home down in Florida together. I hope all's well with you, Sean.
All's good. And by the way, why does Geraldo always have a police car next to him with the lights whizzing around? But listen, please.
In this case, it's to keep the traffic from killing me.
Yeah, that's probably true. Listen, will you please tell all our friends, all these people that, sacrificed, offered their professionalism, their training, their expertise, we really thank them. They've done amazing work both in Texas and Florida. We can't thank these guys enough. And on the 16th anniversary of 9/11 and the five-year anniversary of Benghazi, all those people, all those heroes, it shows how great this country can be, Geraldo. Thank you.
Roger that, Sean.
All right. Hurricane Irma left a massive trail of destruction all throughout the great state of Florida. On the ground with the very latest. Yes, Southwest Florida, my second home in Naples. Steve Harrigan. Steve.
Sean, it's pitch black tonight in Naples. More than 200,000 people across Collier County without electric power on day two. Across the state of Florida, more than 6 million people without power, but there is help on the way. More than 50,000 power workers from across the U.S. and Canada are on their way to Florida to try and help get power up. Of course, it's going to be tough in the heat here with no air conditioning running. As far as the damage goes, you could get a good look at it during the day across the Naples area. A lot of downed trees, huge trees pulled up from the roots. The wind gusts here got over 140 miles per hour. Down power lines as well, so tough to get around on the roads, especially with those stoplights not working and a lot of stop signs knocked over as well. The real challenge is going to be to get that power up, but there is some flooding in some areas as well, too. 3 to 4 feet of flooding, especially in some mobile home areas, and that's going to be a problem. But the most dangerous thing that people were worried about before the storm hit here was a possible surge of 10 to 15 feet. Because the storm was weaker than expected on the back end, that did not happen. So while hard times here right now, no deaths reported from this storm here. Sean, back to you.
All right, thank God. And they were worried because Hurricane Andrew had a bigger surge. And so they thought it was very possible. They took all the precautions. And even the police department down there, Collier County, Lee County, I know these guys. I know the sheriff of Lee County. Amazing job that they've done. Steve, thank you. Also on the ground, live in Florida tonight, Rick Leventhal. He is in Daytona Beach. Rick, what's going on there tonight?
Well, Sean, a countywide curfew just went into effect minutes ago here in Volusia County from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., in part because of all the flooded streets and the debris in the roads and the 150 traffic lights that got knocked out by this storm, which dumped 8 to 12 inches of rain here in a very short period of time, bringing tropical storm force winds for roughly 12 hours overnight, along with hurricane force wind gusts. The results worse than expected by many people here since the storm had turned west and had spared the East Coast a direct hit. We saw countless trees down and signs damaged and storefronts smashed and some vehicles swamped. And actually the hardest hit area that we found was in Ormond Beach, a few miles away from us here, where the Volusia County Sheriff and some locals say that a tornado actually touched down between about 9 and 9:30 last night. The damages seem to support that claim with a line of uprooted trees and downed utility poles and badly damaged homes with roofs ripped off and deposited in neighbors' yards or in the middle of the street a block away. Hundreds of thousands of people remain in the dark here in Volusia County tonight, Sean, and they can probably expect that the lights will remain off for some time to come.
All right, Rick Leventhal, thank you. He's on the ground in Daytona Beach, Florida. Rick, as always, thank you. Also on the ground tonight in Tampa, Florida, our own Mike Tobin. Mike, what's going on there? They were hit a lot less hard than they anticipated, thank God.
You know, the way one cop put it to me as the storm was abating here, this town got lucky. The biggest issue they're facing, like so many other communities, is power outages. Tampa Electric alone, some 333,000 people are without power. Crews were staged ahead of the storm, but they were staged out of harm's way. So that means they have to spend the day driving. The work starts tomorrow. There are communities that say it will be weeks before the power is turned back on. Tampa Electric says the lights will be back on in a matter of days. The biggest culprit was downed trees. Leslie Wilson knows that all too well. She has a giant tree in her front yard. It came crashing down during the middle of the storm. She says no. She's just glad that no one was injured. There was a steeple on the historic New Salem Primitive Baptist Church that got ripped off during the course of the storm. Pastor Benjamin Curry was there making repairs today. He says he thanks God that no one was hurt and says with a new hole in the roof, you can see all the way to heaven. Schools are trying to get back to normal operations, hopefully by Thursday. The St. Pete's Clearwater International Airport is resuming flights tomorrow. Sean?
All right, Mike Tobin, thanks so much. All right, a lot of ground to get to tonight. When we come back, good versus evil, the best and worst in humanity, 16 years after 9/11, 2001, 5 years after Benghazi, Texas, Florida. We'll have a monologue about government, good and evil, government working and not working, and the best of America, and some of the worst. We have disturbing reports and video out of Florida, looting taking place in the wake of Hurricane Irma and price gouging. The Attorney General of that state, Pam Bondi, is next, and our monologue straight ahead. Welcome back to Hannity. Now, tonight, as Americans come to terms with the devastation caused by Hurricane Irma, we are reminded of the anniversary now, the 16th anniversary of 9/11/2001. Tragedy, evil, heartbreak, loss. You know what? While in the midst of all of that, we do see the very best and sometimes the very worst in people in this country. And I got to tell you, that's tonight's important monologue. All right, so now we have Tropical Storm Irma's pounding Georgia on its way to Tennessee. Floridians, they're only beginning to assess the damage, devastation that is caused by this historic storm. And thankfully, just like what we saw with Hurricane Harvey just a couple of weeks ago in Texas, government, state, local, federal officials, they're actually on their game. They were more than prepared. They have been responding in the best way possible to prevent widespread loss of life. And you know what? It's good to see that. We're also seeing the very best from you, the American people, and areas that are directly impacted, neighbor, helping neighbor. And that has expanded out with so many other Americans volunteering, donating money, food, water, supplies, baby formula, cots and blankets and pillows, everything that fellow Americans need. And like we saw in Texas, you know what? It's good to see, as a small government conservative, finally government can work. There can be coordination between local, federal, and state governments. The governors have been great. The federal government's been great. Local officials have been great. Now, unfortunately, in Florida, we're also seeing some of the very worst, but it's a select few Americans. Take a look at this sad video. People looting during the hurricane in Fort Lauderdale. Authorities are saying that, you know, so far 9 people have been arrested for looting. Miami-Dade County police tweeted out earlier today, 28 people have been arrested. And due to what officials are saying, safety concerns, that county is now under a 12-hour curfew that started at 7 p.m. earlier tonight. Now, thankfully, authorities, they're doing an excellent job of cracking down on despicable behavior. They hopefully will hold these people accountable for their actions. There's also, sadly, reports of price gouging. Gas, other vital items that the people of Florida need are in really short supply due to the hurricane. And just take a look at a couple of these headlines. Hurricane Irma, price gouging, scam, complaints. They now exceed 8,000. And Hurricane Irma, a case of water selling for $99.99 on Amazon as residents fear price gouging. Now, the Florida Attorney General Pam Bondi will be here in just a minute. She'll react to all of this. But I want to remind you, 16 years ago today, America experienced pure, unmitigated evil. The attacks on the World Trade Center, the Pentagon, the downing of United Flight 93. It killed nearly 3,000 of our fellow citizens. Now, these are images that will forever be burned into all of our memories and horrors we will never forget, nor should we ever forget. We got to warn you, what we're about to show you is graphic. I know some networks won't show it. It's important we never forget, especially in light of the recent deal. Why would we give money to North Korea and Iran? It's insanity. We've got to know who our enemies are. Al-Qaeda terrorists, they hijacked 2 commercial jets. They flew them directly into the World Trade Center towers, turning the symbols of American capitalism and strength into infernos, death traps. Remember, the flames were so hot, people had to jump. They'd rather choose to jump to their death rather than be incinerated. And then 56 minutes after the South Tower was hit, it came crashing down, raining down tons of steel, debris, thick, gray, ash, and dust all over the streets of New York City. And then 30 minutes after the South Tower fell, the North Tower came crumbling down, leaving behind nothing but misery, death, destruction, despair on a scale this country had never seen before. Now, while innocent Americans were fleeing for their lives, we cannot forget this day. The brave men, women, the firefighters, the police, the first responders, while everybody is racing to get out of those buildings, they're going in the other direction, risking their lives, going into danger, trying to save as many as their fellow Americans as possible. That day, 343 firefighters and paramedics, they lost their their lives. 23 PD officers were killed that day. 37 Portland police officers. They made the ultimate sacrifice. This is what America is. This is what we stand for. And let me add one other thing. So many men and women around this country after 9/11, they signed up for the military. 5,500 of them lost their lives, many others with life debilitating injuries. All of them heroes, all of them fighting for us, all of them saving lives, and they did it without even thinking twice. They ran headfirst, all of them, into danger. And just days after the city and the country started to begin the process of recovery, and eventually they started rebuilding in the same exact place where the Twin Towers once stood, the Freedom Tower now sits there at 1,776 feet tall. This is the type of spirit, the determination I argue America needs more than ever. The people in Texas, the people in Florida, the country, you know what? It's nice to see us unite for a little bit, and for our leaders and government to do the same and start getting things done that benefit the forgotten men and women in this country, you, the American people. I've always been a small government conservative my entire life. The Texas, Florida governors, lieutenant governors, the attorney general, Pam Bondi, who will join us in just a moment, the president, local authorities, our military, all work together in Texas. They all work together in Florida. It's refreshing. Now I'd argue this. It's time for Congress to follow that example, follow that lead, start doing your job. It's like the American people are begging you, build on this success in Texas, Florida, Georgia, other states severely impacted by Irma. Give them the federal assistance they need to rebuild. And also, you need to start passing the agenda you all promised the American people when you ran for office. People voted for you for that agenda. Historic Reagan-esque tax reform that the president is asking for. What's so wrong? What's not Reagan-esque about 7 tax brackets to 3? Cutting middle-class tax rates, slashing corporate tax rates to 15%, allowing multinational companies to repatriate trillions of dollars being held overseas because it would be taxed to death over here so they can build factories and manufacturing centers and hire new workers and, again, create opportunity for Americans. And building at least 300 miles of border wall to protect Americans from people like Al-Qaeda, other terrorist organizations. And it might be a good idea to do it in the next 14 weeks. You all promised this, especially energy independence, the millions of high-paying career jobs that we would have. Replacing, repealing Obamacare. Congress, get your act together. Learn from the good part of the American people. They're leading by example. You're supposed to be servants. Do your job. Here now with reaction, Florida Attorney General Pam Bondi. You know, I know it's a small minority, Pam. It's very small. What does a case of water cost? $4? $5? All right, maybe they want to raise the price a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. $100, well, $50,
Sean, by the way,
$40.
Best monologue I've ever heard you do, especially on September 11th. It was pretty beautiful, what you just said.
You
know, Sean, yeah, water, and I'll tell you what Amazon's done, though. Amazon, these were third-party vendors. I was on the phone with Amazon Corporate. They brought in their entire team in Seattle. They started, of course, they have their automated system. They brought in a team of people and started manually scrubbing it. They've already banned 500 third-party people from going on Amazon and selling. So there's a lot of bad, but there's a lot of good. Yeah, we've seen convenience stores gouging. You know, locally, 7-Elevens were ridiculous, but they were franchises. Corporate 7-Eleven called me, and then they donated to make up for these. And we're going to go after their franchises, by the way, the bad ones. But 7-Eleven overall, the 10,000 stores were great. They've donated $150,000 to the American Red Cross and $100,000 bottles of water to our state. Tomorrow, Home Depot, it's starting to rain on us right now. Tomorrow, Home Depot, they are sending a convoy of trucks, Sean, 80 trucks down to South Florida. Waters are going to be $297 a case, plywood generators, extension cords. So we've seen a lot of good. And I'll tell you what, if you're gouging in our state, we're going to go after you. And Governor Rick Scott has saved so many lives. He said to say hi, Sean, by the way, because he got the people out of our state. I'm so blessed to have him as our governor.
I'll be honest, and it was just refreshing. I mean, we've seen when hurricanes can become a disaster. You know, for example, Katrina. But here's what I want to ask you. if you go back to Ferguson, Missouri, if you go to Baltimore and all these people, all the looting and all that went on there, we have video of these people. We can identify them. They never use the video, and these people end up getting away with it. Is that going to happen in this case? Or are you going to search out every, like, we can see their faces right there. We know who they are.
Oh, Sean, all of our sheriffs are all over it. Our National Guard has been fully deployed. Cannot thank them enough. Federal assistance we've coming in thanks to President Trump. Our state, we are going to be in good shape. If you're looting from our citizens, we're going to go after you. If you're price gouging in our state, I'm going to go after you. And I will shame you on national TV. I will call you out. And you know, we're going to now see people coming in from other states trying to sell generators for $1,000 to take care of, you know, to hurt people in need who have babies at home and no power. And but for the most part, people, the Red Cross has been amazing. People are working so well together. One thing, if I can mention to your viewers, assignment of benefits. People now are going to start coming to your door, wanting to repair your homes. They're going to start wanting to be, say they're contractors. Make sure they're licensed. Do not assign your insurance benefits over to any contractor. Talk to your insurance company first. That's one of the big scams we're going to start seeing, as well as charity scams. And you and I were on earlier with Reverend Franklin Graham, who has a phenomenal charity as well. But, you know, we're going to start seeing some of the bad charities come in as well. That's right. Samaritan's Purse, RedCross.org, all the good ones.
Pam, please go after these people. You know what? There's nothing worse. And I know it's a small minority. Nothing worse than doing this to your fellow Floridians. And thank God most people are not like this. But those that are, I hope you throw them in jail. All of them. All right, Pam. Thank you.
Well,
all the best to our friends
in Florida. Thank you. Thanks, Sean.
Go ahead. Okay. Thank you. When we come back, Hillary Clinton blaming everybody for her election loss. You won't believe what she's literally now saying. And Greg Jarrett, Larry Elder, they have reaction next on this busy breaking news night. Stay with us. Welcome back to Hannity. Now, despite suffering a devastating loss in last year's election, Hillary Clinton won't go away. Now, the two-time failed presidential candidate is out with a brand new book entitled What Happened. This weekend on CBS, Clinton previewed her new book and, not surprisingly, blamed pretty much anything and everything under the sun for her loss except herself. Trump happened. What's this?
Journalists who I have a great deal of respect for, like Nate Silver, burrowed into all the data and said, but for that Comey letter, she would have won. But even though that was the primary blow to my campaign at the very end, it has to be looked at in context with the Russians weaponizing information, negative stories about me, this whole WikiLeaks beginning to leak in early October of John Podesta's emails. Facebook was taking money from Russian companies to run negative stories about me. And then let's not forget sexism and misogyny, which are endemic to our society.
I don't even know what to say. Here with the reaction, Fox News anchor attorney Greg Jarrett, Salem, nationally syndicated radio host Larry Elder. Greg, I'll start with you. Let's see. Russia, Comey, WikiLeaks, fake news, Facebook, voter ID laws, sexism, misogyny. And the only thing she didn't mention in this case was she was an awful candidate, the right-wing conspiracy, and Donald Trump happened. That didn't come up at all. She was a horrible candidate.
I keep a running tally. It's now up to 26 people and events and conditions she's blamed. Psychiatrists have a term
26.
For what she does. Yeah, it's called projection. It's when you're utterly incapable of accepting personal responsibility, you blame others because you view yourself as a chronic victim, very much like Richard Nixon when he famously said in his second Watergate speech, I accept responsibility and not the blame. And like Nixon, all of the scandals that are synonymous with the name Hillary are self-created. Nobody forced her to set up her private email server. Nobody forced her to pocket $225,000 from Goldman Sachs. Nobody forced her to use her foundation like a personal piggy bank that smacks of influence peddling and self-dealing. She did it all on her own, but she's utterly incapable of the courage of honest self-reflection.
That's so well said. I wish I said it that well. That was really well said.
There's your monologue tomorrow.
Okay, I'll steal every word and I'll just plagiarize it and then she'll blame me. Well, she does blame talk radio and of course the Fox News Channel. But all right, Larry, the media narrative on her, she's brilliant. She is so smart. If you watch her campaign, she was boring, she was dull, she had no urgency, and she was basically a walking bumper sticker talking point of every campaign the Democrats have ever run. I never saw anything that inspired anybody, and then all of the scandals that Greg mentioned.
And I don't know whether or not Obama is on Greg's list, but Obama should have been, because this election was a referendum of the 8 years of Obama, and he gave us the worst economic recovery we've had since 1949, the first recovery where we haven't had a single year of 3% growth. And the difference between 2%, which is what we've had, and 3% is a million jobs times the length of the recovery. So if Obama had done nothing but practice his jump shot, as I mentioned before, we would have had 7 million more jobs. Now, what's she going to say? She's not made any criticism of any decision that he's made economically. How could she? Because she was okay with all of them, including the mandate, which Obama did not want during the campaign. So she can't criticize any decision he's made economically. But when you ask Americans who voted in 2016, the number one concern was the economy and jobs.
Absolutely. And the forgotten men and women. Yeah, you know, I guess the media and liberals, they love to diagnose Donald Trump's mental state. I'm listening to Hillary, and would it be wrong of me to say narcissistic personality disorder, Greg?
Yeah, absolutely.
Where's the introspection?
Right.
Self-analysis here.
There is none. Wouldn't it be refreshing if she said, look, I ran an abysmal campaign. I was a lousy candidate. I never truly understood what Americans care about.
I'm laughing.
I never developed a message that resonated with voters. Again, that would require a measure of honesty and self-reflection. And she can't acknowledge the truth. And she never will.
And Sean, right, she could have said,
"Yeah, Larry."
She could have said, "My husband governed from the center. He cut capital gains. He did the Welfare Reform Act of 1996. My boss governed from the hard left." But she can't say that.
All right, stay right there. We're going to have more with Greg and Larry right after this break. And also coming up tonight, a blockbuster interview, 60 Minutes. White House former chief strategist Steve Bannon making major headlines in his first television interview since leaving the White House. We're going to play you the highlights. Also, the man that killed bin Laden and a good friend of mine who lost her brother, one of the pilots on 9/11, 2001. Straight ahead. Hey, welcome back to Hannity. So last night, 60 Minutes aired the first TV interview with former Trump White House chief strategist Steve Bannon. Now, since he left the White House, that is. During the sit-down, Bannon attacked the Washington establishment hard. By the way, they deserve it, and so much more. Let's take a look at this.
The Republican establishment is trying to nullify the 2016 election. That's a brutal fact we have to face. They do not want Donald Trump's populist, economic, nationalist agenda to be implemented. It's very obvious. The drain and swamp thing was Mitch McConnell was day one. Did not want to go there, wanted us to back off.
Do you accept no responsibility for the failures of this administration?
And when you say failures, it's 8 months in. Give me a failure. But Obama didn't have Obamacare for the first 18 months. You're holding him to an unfair standard. Trump went around the room and asked people the percentages he thought of still winning and what the recommendation. And Reince started off and Reince said, you have two choices. You either drop out right now or you lose by the biggest landslide in American political history. I was the last guy to speak and I said, it's 100%. You have 100% probability of winning. And that's the first time.
Well, you seem to have done that at every point in the campaign when he was in trouble, asking him to double down on his rhetoric, double down in terms of appealing to his base.
Appealing to the American people and to the working class people in this country, absolutely.
I don't think there's any doubt that if James Comey had not been fired, we would not have a special counsel, yes.
So we would not have the Mueller investigation?
We would not have the Mueller investigation. We would not have the Mueller investigation in the breadth that clearly Mr. Mueller is going.
Someone said to me that you described the firing of James Comey, you're a student of history, as the biggest mistake in political history.
That would be probably too bombastic even for me, but maybe modern political history.
As we continue with Larry Elder, Greg Jarrett, you know, Larry, I talk about five forces against the president. One of the five forces is the Republican establishment, weak Republicans, the never Trumper Republicans. And then I watch Mitch McConnell. Well, the expectations were too high on health care. I agree with Bannon. They are not a positive force for change, and they're deeply involved in the sewer and swamp. Thoughts?
Well, for 7 years, they've been talking about repealing and replacing Obamacare. And the reason for the unification was because of Barack Obama. Barack Obama is no longer there. Now the Republicans have been exposed. A number of these Republicans are not true fiscal conservatives. They don't really believe in repealing Obamacare. They believe in repealing it and replacing it with another government scheme. That's the problem. Many of these guys are not people that are truly principled. And the fact that Obama has gone away now shows this. And Trump, unfortunately, is the vehicle for this. Look, Donald Trump won. These guys did not expect him to win. They have no idea what to do with him. He's not a conventional politician. He is, in fact, a populist, as Stephen Bannon has pointed out.
All right, let me go to you, Greg. I disagree on the Comey part of what Steve Bannon said. Here's why. If somebody's so unethical and so conflicted, and now we know the fix was in, he was, before interviewing Hillary or all these witnesses, he was already writing her exoneration. That's not equal justice under the law by any measure.
Comey should have been fired a long time ago. He usurped the authority of the attorney general. He broke all the rules in making his public announcement. And then he blatantly misinterpreted the law. And I never understood, like you, how he could exonerate Hillary Clinton given the plethora of incriminating criminality. Now we know. The Senate Judiciary Committee has come up with a document, a statement that Comey authored 2 months before he ever interviewed Hillary Clinton or her top aide, exonerating her. Now, how is that possible unless he was told to do it or he decided to do it on his own? But either way, it's interfering with the due process of law. That is obstruction of justice. And there ought to be a special counsel other than his good buddy, Robert Mueller, to open an investigation, to convene a grand jury and decide whether James Comey has committed crimes, including obstruction of justice.
Well, Greg, he got the record. Go ahead, Larry.
I was going to say, Greg, he didn't have to be told what to do. Obama said on several occasions he didn't feel Hillary had done anything. I've known her for a long time.
Which is why I suspect Loretta Lynch. And that's why she ought to be under oath and ought to be the target of a second special counsel, because it looks as though promises were made to the Hillary Clinton campaign. Were they made by Loretta Lynch? What happened on the tarmac inside that plane with Bill Clinton?
Good questions.
Even James
Good
Comey
questions.
Said the reason he took it over was because he was suspicious of the motive and actions of Loretta Lynch.
But all trails, Greg, lead to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. All trails lead to Barack Obama. That's why this investigation went supernova. That's why it went away.
Yeah, you may be right.
I think there's something to that. But the bottom line is, I don't think we're done with the email server scandal. I don't think we're done with Comey, with Lynch, with Ukraine election interference, nor Uranium One. Or, by the way, Debbie Wasserman Schultz. All right, guys, thank you both.
Sure.
When we come back today, President Trump remembered the 9/11 2001 attacks and said his administration will work hard to make sure terrorists never again have a safe haven to launch attacks against this country. Rob O'Neill, the man that killed Osama bin Laden, Deborah Burlingame. She lost her brother, one of the pilots of American Airlines, will join us next, straight ahead.
These are horrible, horrible enemies, enemies like we've never seen before. But we're ensuring that they never again have a safe haven to launch attacks against our country. We are making plain to these savage killers that there is no dark corner beyond our reach, no sanctuary beyond our grasp, and nowhere to hide. Anywhere on this very large earth.
President Trump earlier today at the Pentagon remembering the 9/11 2001 terrorist attacks. Joining us now, the man that killed Osama bin Laden, author of the bestseller, The Operator, former Navy SEAL, Fox News contributor Rob O'Neill. Every time at this time of year, Rob, I play on my radio show Michael W. Smith's song, and we intersperse all this audio about from news reports, and the towers hit, the next towers hit, the Pentagon, Field in Pennsylvania, towers crashing down. Every time I hear it, it just brings me back like it's yesterday. Yeah. You had the unique opportunity to kill the guy responsible. Do you ever reflect on that?
First of all, Sean, thank you for having me on the anniversary. It's such a special day. And just like you, I hear those things. It brings me right back. And it's surreal how fast time flies. And you asked me if I can ever, I can close my eyes anytime I want and see my team going up the stairs to get Osama bin Laden. And I can remember the feeling of what it's like to know we're facing death ourselves, but it's worth it for the innocent people that died in the towers and the first responders that went there, the people on Flight 93 in Pennsylvania and the people in the Pentagon. And it's, again, you know, I was just down there today at the 9/11 Memorial. It's always incredible to go there, and I like to go there a lot more than just on the memorial, because it makes me realize what's really important. It makes, like President Trump said in his speech today, that we realize when major catastrophes like that, like the terrorist attack, or even the hurricanes now, we realize how small our differences really are, and that once we're united as a country, we can defeat anything. And he made that pretty clear.
I love the fact that he's taking it to them and he's serious. Did you read about bin Laden's son? And I think you saw some of his kids. Do you in particular remember him? Do you remember if he was there that day, that he is going to now unite all these terrorists?
No, his younger son Hamza was not there. His older brother Khalid was there, and he said the same nonsense. And we ran into him and took care of him quickly. And that's the same fate that Hamza is going to reach. We got men and women looking for him right now, and it's going to be a bad day for him when we do find him. Supposedly he's going to unite it, but that's all they have as a kid. It's because we're routing ISIS now. We've hit Al Qaeda really, really hard, and this is what they have. It's the same ideology that ISIS has, that Al Qaeda has, that Al Shabaab has, the Khorasan group, any of those savages in North Africa that are uniting under this. This radicalized version of Islam. You know, they're scraping for something. He's going to rattle his saber, but he's not going to do much.
Mm-hmm. All right, Rob, thanks. You did a great service along with all the members of SEAL Team 6. None of you knew if you were coming back. Great heroism. And all the people that fought in Afghanistan and Iraq, many that lost their lives, and those that came back with the most severe injuries. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Sean.
Deborah Burlingame. Thank you. She lost her brother on 9/11, 2001. You know, Deborah, we've become friends over the years, and you have been such a strong, powerful voice against radicalism. You know, we're seeing the impact of believing something as naive as North Korea. If we bribe them, then they're going to stop the nuclear program. Then President Obama makes this idiotic deal with Iran. And I think back, and I think you lost your brother that day. How are we really that stupid that we don't understand the mentality of evil in our time?
We're not that stupid, but we have a leadership, I'm not confining that to politicians, but also the cultural leaders, the thought leaders in our country, the heads of Middle East Studies departments in colleges and universities, who are obsessed with, you know, something called hate speech and worrying about the other. And you know, if we had those people running the show in World War II, we might have had quite a different outcome there. The way President Trump talked today about the enemy was very important to me, so important to me and so refreshing to me that I sort of knuckled mine into the rope line so I could thank him for simply saying that our loved ones were murdered that day. That is the first time I heard a president since 9/11 use the term murder. And I felt it was really important to say, to thank him for that. And he actually said something interesting to me. He said, my people didn't want me to use that word. And I decided to say it anyway. And I said, well, I'm glad you did. And I got to tell you, Sean, I heard from 9/11 family members today. I hadn't spoken to them, and they said, did you hear he used the word murdered? Because it bothers us when we hear euphemisms like they were lost or they were taken from us. And when we see these mass casualty attacks, outrageous attacks in Nice, in Orlando, in London, in Brussels,
San Bernardino,
where they are targeting
Fort
innocent
Hood,
civilians, children,
Boston.
And there's all this worry about using the wrong words to describe the killers who did it. It was refreshing to hear this today. And one of the things that, if I may say, I learned was reading one of the affidavits from Khalid Sheikh Mohammed that was taken from him and entered into evidence in the Massawi trial. He said that they absolutely planned a second wave of attacks, but were basically knocked on their heels. What they didn't imagine was the aggressive response by the American people, by the Americans. And that's what gets it done.
It was the right thing.
Yes.
Deborah, I gotten to know you over these years, and your voice, with all you've been through, has been extremely powerful over the years. My thoughts and prayers with you this day, too. Thank you for being with
us
and all the families.
I appreciate it so much. You have been a very good friend and a good friend to the American people.
Same with you. Thank you. Deborah Burlingame. When we come back, important message from me to a friend of our family right here on the Fox News Channel. Now, before we go tonight, we want to send our deepest, deepest condolences to the entire Bowling family, our friend Eric and his wife Adrian. Over the weekend, our former colleague and his wife Adrian, they lost their only child, Eric Chase. He passed away Friday in Colorado, where he was going to college. Just want to say to my friend, our thoughts and prayers are with you. We love you, and we're thinking about you in this most difficult time. Thanks for being with us. Remember, the show will always be fair and balanced. John Scott continues straight ahead. We'll see you back here tomorrow night.